My name is Antonio Colombo, and I have the pleasure to present this overview about DCP in 2022 in 21. The topic of DCP started with treatment of in-stent restenosis. And if we look at the two recent studies, RIPS4 and Daedalus meta-analysis, both gave an advantage to drug-eluting stent over DCB for treatment of in-stent restenosis. So, should we conclude that DCB have a limited role to treat in-stent restenosis? I would say no, because the limitation of this study is related to the optimal lesion preparation, which was not always completely obtained before using DCB. Usage of a DCB with better late loss may also have an advantage over a paclitaxel-eluting DCB, which have a late loss in this study of an average of 1/3 of a millimeter. What we learn from DCB predilatation. We go back to an old study that we published in 2016, and is not a randomized study, but is interesting because it's a retrospective analysis of in-stent restenosis treated by DCB. All had predilatation. And 166 lesions were classified as adequate or inadequate based on the predilatation result. And adequate was a T3 fluid diameter stenosis less than 30%, no major dissection. Inadequate was one of the three, less than T3 flow. What would you say, moderate residual stenosis over 30% or major dissection? When we look at the result according to this classification, we see that 98 lesions had an adequate result and 68 lesions had an inadequate result. All of these underwent DCB treatment. And here you see the TLR at the follow-up. I think the cumulative event rate with adequate are in blue, inadequate in red. You see that there is a significant increase in target lesion revascularization when you go to adequate versus inadequate. On the right side, you see a landmark analysis at 1 year where you start seeing the split between the two curves. So, if we clump these two groups together, we may conclude that drug-coated balloon is not so advantageous. But then, if we take on the side the inadequate predilatation, the difference is clear. So, the message is that you use a drug-coated balloon only if the predilatation gives you an optimal result. Another point that I like to stress is to utilize new technologies to improve the result of predilatation. Here is the ISER Desire 4, published in 2015, where the usage of AngioSculpt, which is a scoring balloon, before implementing a drug-coated balloon treatment for in-stent restenosis, lowered the binary restenosis rate at 6 months from 32% to 18% with a routine 6 months angiography. So, again, drug-coated balloon has to be applied only if optimal predilatation is performed. Moving to another field, is the small vessel. We have this almost landmark study, basket small two, randomizing 382 patients with drug-coated balloon and 376 with death. Our current generation death, except 25%, had old taxus, and the MACE rate was 7.5 and 7.3 at 1 year follow-up. So I think when you treat small vessel, you have no inferiority of drug-coated balloon, and maybe even some advantage related to the no need to increase the duration of dual antiplatelet therapy. And here you see another study a little bit earlier, done with old generation drug-coated balloon, the Bello study. We see at 3 years in blue the MACE rate of drug-coated balloon, in red of the paclitaxel eluting stent. You see that the two curves keep on diverging with a clear advantage at 3 years for drug-coated balloon. So I think when you treat vessels smaller than 3 millimeter, you can set 275, 25, but I would say vessel where you would not implant, where you would implant a 2.5 stent, there is an advantage in utilizing a drug-coated balloon, or at least there is no disadvantage. Another lesion that I really consider ideal for this treatment is a single ostial stenosis of the circumflex that you see in this view. Implantation of a stent here frequently leads to a plaque shift towards the LAD and is not rare to end up with two stents implanted, including coverage of the left main. This case was treated with optimal predilatation, cutting balloon, 3-0 at 22 atmosphere, and then treatment with a drug-coated balloon or DCB at the ostium of the circumflex. Here we use MAGIC TAX, sirolimus eluting DCB, 20 millimeter, 3.5, and no stent implanted. And here you see the final result. It's almost a stent-like result, but most importantly, the lumen cross-sectional area is 9.2 at IVUS, with the distal left main of 12, so confirmation even by IVUS of an optimal result. We can go one step further and utilize this technology to treat long diffuse disease. My point is that in the upper frame, when you're dealing with focal stenosis, the question about utilizing a stent is easily answered. These lesions are ideal for stent. But when you have a diffuse disease, like in the LAD in the lower frame, I would add, consider DCB with FFR evaluation. I make the general considerations. Large vessels over 3 millimeter and short stent less than 25 with optimal result evaluated with imaging are the default approach, and no issue to challenge these concept verified over decades or even longer. In other situations, such as long lesions with diffuse disease, what should we consider? Use of the same approach and implant a long stent with imaging optimization or optimal lesion preparation, maybe with PDPA and FFR evaluation, and then treat with DCB. The result may not be the stent-like, but consider that the lower the gain, the lower the loss. So in this approach, with this approach, we may not get an ideal stent-like result, but the long-term follow-up may be pleased by a more favorable late loss. Consider the setting. If baseline FFR was 75 and after lesion preparation is 85 and then the follow-up is 82 despite a mediocre angio result, any problem? So I think we have to accept when you treat a diffuse disease not to have a stent-like result, but look at the follow-up result, which may not be as beautiful as a stent-like result after having implanted a long stent. This is a one intermediate branch, 3 millimeter or 275, long disease. This was treated with predilatation. There is some linear dissection, but excellent flow. In addition, we did PDPA with 92, so only 8 millimeter of gradient, and we decided to treat with a drug-coated balloon and not with a stent. This is a more extreme example, focal lesion at the origin of a diagonal with a lot of diffuse disease in a tortuous distal LED. There are two approaches. You can treat the proximal lesion, but then you have a lot of diffuse disease left distally, despite a good result at the bifurcation. Here, doing a QFR, you see that there is a diffuse disease, not only at the lesion site, but also distally throughout the LED. Instead of converting this vessel into a full metal jacket, we decided to do PCI with drug-coated balloon. You see that there is some linear dissection in the mid-LED. Very good result at the origin of the diagonal. As a matter of fact, we didn't even implant a stent there. IVUS shows a residual lumen, which is adequate. Again, it's not a stent-like, but very, very acceptable. You see the steel frames below. And this is a final. I think it's clear that you have a double lumen in the middle of the LED with a dissection. The QFR was repeated, and you see that there are only some critical lesion, very, very distal, but all the vessel is now blue, yellow, distally, so it's acceptable, may not be perfect, but certainly not fully red at the beginning. But more important, I come back here, at the follow-up, this vessel was widely patent and perfect. The interesting point I like to highlight is that now we can measure the pressure gradient utilizing a monorail pressure system without removing the wire and without utilizing a new pressure wire. But this monorail catheter allows to measure the pressure distally and proximally on the same wire that we utilize to perform PCI. We can obtain IFR as denominated in this setting as CRR, which is basically the same, with a cutoff value of 0.89. So this is a very simple system, very friendly to use. So, should we take over some lesions that are now stenting? Yes, but only for lesions where stent performs suboptimally, such as diffuse disease, small vessel, ostial circumflex, and of course, in-stent restenosis. Successful lesion preparation can be assessed by measuring the final pressure gradient, PDPA, that should not be higher than 10, or by imaging, IVUS or OCT. A study by the group of Park in Korea posted a prognostic value or proximal to distal gradient established as 0.8 as a cutoff for success. We have put 10 millimeters, so we have used a more restrictive value just to improve safety. So a successful lesion preparation should lead to death implantation, but if you can achieve this goal, you can safely switch to drug-coated balloon. Thank you for your attention.